Okie dokie, let's get started with today's video. Hey everyone, how's it going? Hope you are well. Today we're going to be talking about learning. The more you know. So questions that I get often in my DMs are questions like, how do you stay up to date with new technologies? Or how do you stay relevant with the tech industry when things are moving so fast? So we're gonna hit on three things today. Whether it's true that you always need to stay up to date with new technologies to stay relevant, my own experiences with it, and if it is true, and if it's not a myth, how to go about doing it and how to think about it. Let's get started. So it's no secret that new technologies are coming out all the time. When new technologies are always coming out, it is kind of true that you do have to stay up to date with new technologies. But it's also true that not everyone is an expert in every new technology, and a lot of software engineers and most companies will not adopt these new technologies as soon as they come out or even 2 to 5 years out. And personally, I think that one of the best and also scariest things about being a software engineer is precisely this, that you're always going to be learning as a software engineer. And I also want to note that always learning doesn't necessarily mean that you're always learning new technologies, you're always just learning new skills. And we're going to touch on that in a little bit, but before we do that, I wanted to just kind of talk about almost the essence of software engineering. And I think the essence is that you're always failing. It's literally a career about failing, learning from your failures, and gaining skills and doing better next time. If you think about how software is always iterative, I think it's just based on that precipice of you're always going to fail and you're always going to make mistakes, but there's so much to learn from all of those mistakes so that you can do better next time. I think it's also based on the fact that there's nothing perfect in software engineering. There's no perfect line of code. There's no perfect software engineer. There's no perfect application or code base. For those of you who do have experience diving into existing code bases, you know that there's a lot of dust bunnies and weird architectural decisions and just lots of cruft that exists. I know that whenever I start a new job, I'm like, oh, your app is great. Like, it's so stable and it's probably made so well. And then I peek behind the covers and I'm like, what is this mess? This makes no sense. And I think you'll just find that at all of the roles. Nothing is perfect in software engineering. So once you realize that nothing is perfect, then also you realize that, oh, it's totally okay to make mistakes and fail and just learn from your failures because there's just so much to learn all the time. Now, it took a little bit for me to wrap my head around the fact that I'm always gonna be failing. So I just wanna take us back to like my first job as a software engineer where I was doing iOS development. Now, I hadn't really done any meaningful amount of iOS development before that. Like, I made an app once with some people, of which I wrote maybe a couple lines of code. So I knew that in my first role, I would need to do a lot of learning. I had no idea how to use Xcode. I barely wrote Objective-C. And so that's the thing that I really focused on in my first couple of years. So that's exactly what I did. I told my manager, hey, I know nothing. Please help me learn something so that I can be a valuable software engineer and contribute to the code base and the team and the application. And I just really wanted to be exposed to lots of different parts of iOS development. In all the different areas of software development, web development, security, gaming development, you can go so deep into each area. And within each area, there's lots of other little areas. There's just the whole world to learn basically in each thing. And that's exactly what my manager did. He assigned me books to read, he told me some courses to take, as well as some tutorials to do, and also I found mentors within my team who could also guide me through all of this too. And I really can't emphasize enough how much I didn't know at the beginning, but once I realized and told myself and told others and was honest with myself, like, yo, I don't know stuff, that's where the learning began, because I was willing to accept the fact that, you know, I'm a failure right now, but I can get myself out of this by learning new skills. And yes, the beginning was very, very hard. I remember my very first bug bash, which is where we all sit together and just resolve a bunch of bugs, and sitting there being like, I don't know how to do any of this because I don't know what I'm doing and I can barely read Objective-C. And always being faced with what a little I knew was tough. But those are the little failure points that I turned into motivation to learn new skills. And then after a while, maybe about 6 months to a year, I looked back and I was like, you know, I actually know some stuff, especially compared to my first week on the job. And I'm really proud of myself for putting in that work and accepting the fact that, you know, I don't know a whole lot and I need to learn a lot more. And now I do know a lot more and I feel way more competent as an engineer and I know a lot more about iOS development. I mean, a big part of this is just reaching out for help and asking people and telling people like, yo, help me. I don't know what I'm doing. So that was kind of my experience as an early career software engineer, just absorbing everything about the technology. And now I'm going to get to the point where I mentioned earlier about learning other skills that are also really important. So after I felt like I had a good grasp of iOS development, maybe that was about like 2 years later, I realized that there aren't really other paved paths past this point. It was all just about figuring out what I wanted to get better at, what I failed at, and realizing from there the skills that I want and need in order to progress towards a place that I want to be. Now, this all sounds vague and ambiguous, but really what I'm trying to say is things like product skills, people skills, creativity skills, writing skills, these are all important skills to software engineering that I didn't realize were important at the beginning. And actually, I would argue that in order to become a really well-rounded software engineer, it's not just about the technical skills. You need all of the other skills in order to do a good job. For instance, the people skills that I've worked on have enabled me to talk about technology to non-technical people, and has really translated to like the content that I make on here, which I enjoy doing. I mean, if we're being really honest, if you told me in my first year of working that I would eventually make a YouTube channel about software engineering, I'd be like, what? Nah, that's not happening. But here we are. Because I mean, I realized that I just want to do this and it would be fun. So here I am. Thanks for subscribing. If you're not subscribed, click on the subscribe button. And I realized at this point when there were all these other skills that I would need to learn to be the best person and software engineer I could be, I realized that there's really a merit to being a lifelong learner as a software engineer. And I think that is the really important lesson here. The essence of software engineering means you're always failing, but in order to overcome that, you just have to be a lifelong learner. And the best news is anybody can be a lifelong learner. You just have to have that kind of like, I'm okay to fail. I accept that I fail. I'm going to figure out how not to fail the next time and understand what you need to learn to do better. So you might be asking, what does this actually look like? Like, how do software engineers actually learn the skills that they need to learn? And well, honestly, everybody's different. Some people set aside a certain amount of time every week to learn stuff. Other people take time off to do it and learn it on weekends. But for me, I am a very like purpose-driven learner in a sense that I learn the best when there is a bigger goal that I want to achieve so that I can do some purposeful learning in order to build the skills to get to where I want to go. So when it comes to software, if there's like an app that I want to build or a feature idea that I have, then usually that will kind of be my bigger goal and I will go through tutorials, read books, watch videos to figure out what skills and things I need to learn in order to get that job done. And sometimes that job is literally just like feeding my curiosity. The other day I was like, what the heck is blockchain? And then I watched some videos on it and I feel like I have a better grasp on what it is. And now when people talk about blockchain, I'm like, I know what that is now. And as I mentioned before, as a person, I'm always thinking about who am I? Where do I want to go? What are my current circumstances? Where can I go? What skills do I need to get there so that I make the best use of my time here on this earth in this body? Not existential at all. And I mean, it's also because as a person, it's really hard to define exactly what you want to be and who you want to be. Because these days, there's really no one right way to do life, and it's just full of a myriad of experiences that you wouldn't have predicted would happen at all. So I guess what I'm trying to say is I like to keep it open-ended, and instead I really just let my curiosity fuel my learning. And I don't know how to trigger curiosity, I just get curious, and then I'm just like, I'm gonna learn it. So no tips there. So I'm not the type to like schedule time to learn stuff. I don't set aside X amount of hours to learn about this new framework or anything. I will maybe, if I'm very curious about that framework, find a project that will help me use that project, basically. But yeah, having a purpose helps me stay motivated in learning stuff. And it means a lot of failing and a lot of hard stuff along the way to figure out what I need to do and accepting the fact that I suck at a lot of stuff. But, I mean, that's how you learn, and that is ultimately, I feel like, how you become a lifelong learner. I mean, really, it's kind of a lesson on humility, I think. And the best part is that the internet has opened up so many new ways of learning and consuming content because of all the amazing content creators out there. I personally learned the best from video content, so I'm really happy to say that Skillshare has kindly sponsored this video today. For those of you who don't know, Skillshare is an online learning community with over 25,000 classes on everything from design to web development to business to lifestyle stuff. Literally anything you want to learn, it's on Skillshare. Since I've been doing iOS development for like my whole entire career, I've been really curious about web development. I found this awesome course by Christopher Dodd on Skillshare called Understanding Web Development, A Beginner's Guide to the Web. It talks everything about the difference between front-end and back-end, as well as things like CSS, JavaScript, HTML, really the foundational stuff that's really important to get started in web development. I also really like this other class that I took called Discovering Success, 7 Exercises to Uncover Your Purpose, Passion, and Path by Emma Gannon. So taking this class with really interactive materials and in video form is the best place for me to learn, and I hope it will help you all too. I mean, if you think about the fact that you don't have to go back to college or take in-person classes to learn anymore, it really opens up the opportunities and places for you to learn stuff. So I'm really happy that Skillshare exists. I feel like I'm juggling a lot of stuff all the time, and finding a good place and good resources to learn things that I know nothing about, like Skillshare is an awesome place to do that. They also have a lot of courses in software development, so be sure to check that out, as well as all of the other like non-technical skills that are also really important as a software engineer. And Skillshare is giving away a free 2-month unlimited access trial for my subscribers who click the link in the description box down below, and it's only about $10 a month after that. So definitely be sure to check that out. Thank you again, Skillshare, you're awesome. I love education and learning platforms and stuff. Like, my parents are both teachers, so I'm really excited that they sponsored, so thank you. All right, I hope you liked this video. Give it a thumbs up if you did, and subscribe and hit the bell notification or leave a comment down below. You know the drill. I just want to hear from you all about how you're doing. Okay, that's it for today. I hope you have a great day wherever you are, and let's get learning. Bye!